Today is October 4th, right? Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Tomorrow is October 5th. So in our tradition, this is Darumaki, or Bodhidharma Day, tomorrow, the 5th. It's the memorial of Master Bodhidharma's death. Feeling a bit fiery today, and I don't know, maybe that has something to do with it. I don't know. Let's see. We're going to continue today with the Platform Sutra of Zen Master Huineng. And I may throw some Bodhidharma in here just for good measure to acknowledge this time of year. Bodhidharma Day, Darumaki, is one of the big five. In the tradition that I was trained in, there are five major ceremonies. Three of them pertain to the Buddha, his birthday, the day of his awakening, and the day of his death, Nirvana Day, Nihan E, which is February 15th. And the other two are memorials, which is Bodhidharma Day, which is tomorrow, October 5th, and Rinzai Ki, which is January 15th, I believe, which is the commemoration of Master Rinzai's death. Daruma Ki is also significant in monastic practice, as it's the change from, it's a change of season. That's when traditionally what happens on October 5th is that the summer robe is washed and put away, and the winter robe is brought out for the winter season. So if you live in a place that gets really cold, like I think if we were in Alberta right now or something, we'd have really cold monks, because I've heard it's snowing in some places in Alberta already. So we're going to continue with the Platform Sutra. I'm kind of reviewing the first 11 little sections, which I read sort of as one last week, just to sort of give the story and working through it a little bit more slowly, piece by piece. As I was reviewing it this week, really digging into it, there is a whole lot in just this simple recounting of the personal tale that I'd like to get into. So I'm going to start here in chapter 4, or the fourth section. On one day, so we've just gotten through the third one where the master sort of questions him and calls him a jungle rat, if we remember. How can you come and... You're from Lingnan and a jungle rat as well. How can you possibly be a Buddha? I replied, people come from the north or south, not their Buddha nature. The lives of this jungle rat and the masters aren't the same, but how can our Buddha nature differ? So the master says, uh-oh, we got a live one here. We better get him out of here before everybody realizes it and he gets in trouble for taking that shortcut, coming so well prepared. So he sends him off to the milling room, where he peddled a millstone for more than 8 months. So in section 4, we say, one day, the fifth patriarch suddenly called all of his disciples together. After they assembled, he said, I've told you that the greatest concern for a human being is life and death. But you disciples spend your days making offerings, just looking for ways to reap merit, and not for a way out of the bitter sea of samsara. If you're blind to your own nature, how can you find the doorway to merit? Go back to your rooms and look into yourselves. Those of you who are wise, make use of the prajna wisdom of your own nature. Each of you write me a gatha. When I read your gathas, if any of you understands what is truly important, I will give you my robe and my dharma and appoint you the sixth patriarch. Hurry, as if there were a fire. So I was reviewing this past week as well as this morning, and I just really got a good feeling about this chapter. I wanted to talk about it a little bit. The fifth patriarch calls all of his disciples together, and it's important to point out that at this point, Huineng is not among this group of people. He's not considered a disciple. He's considered a layperson who works at the monastery. In the old days, and still today in some places in China, And in other countries, I'm sure, I think probably in like Burma and Thailand, places where there's a significant number of Buddhists in the monasteries, they sometimes can't do all of the work in the monastery themselves, so they have to hire villagers. Or sometimes people come and just volunteer for the merit of working at a monastery. So basically, everybody thinks that Huineng at this point is just the guy that grinds the mill. So he's sort of undercover, the undercover patriarch already at the monastery. So the fifth patriarch, though, at some point, I think this must be more than 8 months after Huineng's been there, starts poking to see what's going on in his disciples. So he calls all of his disciples together and says, "I've told you that the greatest concern for a human being is life and death." So he's saying, you people are all coming in here every day, and I keep giving you talks, and I keep meeting with you, and I keep answering your questions, and we keep doing this form, and I tell you what this practice is all about. But you disciples spend your day making offerings, just looking for ways to reap merit. This is the same grumbling and complaining that we've heard from Master Rinzai, who's actually later, so maybe it's a genetic flaw or something. But he's saying the same thing. This place is a place of awakening. This place is a place of realizing our fundamental nature, our true nature. It's never been anything different. This is a place since the beginning that we as human beings come to become Buddha, to realize ourselves as nothing other than Buddha. But you people keep coming here to make offerings, to gain merit, to reap merit, and not to find a way out of the bitter sea of samsara. Reaping merit. This is something that people are always really interested in talking about, whether it's on a Tuesday or any time I'm walking down the street. If I'm wearing robes, people will stop me. When I'm at the university, people want to come into the office to talk about karma, to talk about rebirth, to talk about merit and good activities. Good, and I put in quotations. And that's okay. I don't mind talking about that kind of stuff. But to talk about it, or to try to gain some kind of insight into it, or to try to figure out a way of practicing it, from the basic perspective of Zen practice, is misguided at best. When we understand karma, we're talking about, you know, karma that has a positive effect. Or most often people will talk about good and bad karma, right? Let's talk about karma. I'm going to put this book down for a second. Good and bad karma. So when we're talking about good karma, bad karma, we have to understand that from the perspective that holds that there is fundamentally no self, the concept of good and bad has to come from somewhere. So when we're talking about karma, the first thing that we have to do is understand what the word means, what it implies. The word karma simply means activity or action. The word karma refers to the causal nature of this universe, that this results in that, that results in this. When this doesn't happen, that doesn't happen. I always like to say, if you plant a tomato seed, you don't get a carrot plant, right? So we say that karma is the activity of a seed being planted, the causes and conditions for the ripening and maturing of that seed coming forth, and eventually the fruit of that seed arising. There's no moral in it. There's no, this is good or this is bad. It's simply that there is an instigating factor. There are causes and conditions that make it ripen. We put it in good earth, the sun warms it, water is poured on it. And as a result of these things coming together, we have a fruit. When we talk about good and bad karma, already we have fixated a self. Already several things have arisen into the situation. We've given rise to a self. We've given rise to a self that has made a series of choices and preferences. A self that has already been totally immersed and lost into this world of craving and aversion. So as soon as we start talking about good and bad, we've already given rise to the three poisons that we talk about in Buddhism. The first is fundamental confusion or ignorance. And the way that this is manifested is in the fixation with a self. It's called fundamental ignorance or fundamental delusion, fundamental confusion, because it's positing something into the equation which doesn't exist. That's why I prefer this fundamental confusion to the term ignorance that's often used. Ignorance is not knowing, right? Not having the knowledge. And that's not quite what we're talking about. It's not knowing about something that's there. It's positing something which isn't there and grasping it, holding on to it. Fundamental confusion. And out of this fundamental confusion of a self, we look around the world and we say, oh, I like this, and oh, I don't like that. And then we start to make choices. And from that perspective, we start to talk about fruits, particular fruits, as being good or bad. So we have to understand that as soon as we're talking about good and bad, we're actually not talking about any kind of thing that is absolutely good. We're not talking about any kind of thing that's absolutely bad. We could have the same situation arise in two people's lives, and one perspective would be, that's bad karma, and the other person's perspective would be, well, that's good karma. Both would be entirely right, because they're looking at karma. They're looking at this fundamentally neutral or fundamentally, Roshi used to say, the universe doesn't care. And I think that's a really important perspective to grasp when we're practicing. So when we talk about practicing compassion or dana or anything like this from the perspective of good karma, cultivating good karma, we're fundamentally talking about perpetuating a system which is based on a fixed notion of self and improving the situation as is defined by the self in a very positive way. This, from the perspective of Buddhism, is the very foundation of samsara. Samsara being this whole cyclical wheel of life and death, right? Of positive and negative. You've seen the wheel, right, in the Tibetan sort of mandala, and it's got sort of like at the bottom, like people boiling in kettles and spikes through their eyes and all kinds of stuff. The hellish realms, the hungry ghosts, the animals, the human realm, the Asura realm, and the Deva realm, and then we sort of go back down around. And when we're fixated with the self, this is what we do. When we're fixated with amassing merit as a matter of good karma, we continue to sort of get the things that we want. We have the money. This is the sort of concept from a sort of Brahmanic perspective. We have the money. We have the situation. We have the resources that we need. We get lots of sleep. Jobs come easily. We marry somebody beautiful. We have healthy children. But what starts to happen in that situation is we lose touch. We start to feel entitled. We start to feel deserving. Any kind of thing that's negative that happens to us makes us angry. And this puts us in a situation where it becomes more and more easy to sow the seeds of discontent, to engage in activities to medicate or to distract ourselves from our suffering, which is really not continuing to receive what it is we feel that we deserve. So we start to sow these seeds, we start to reap the fruits, and we start to move our way down, back around, oh, deva, asura, human, animal, hungry ghost, hell. Now this cycle is something that the Buddha described as being like impenetrable. As long as we are fixated on these three fundamental poisons, which is fundamental confusion, craving, and aversion, we're stuck on this wheel. So negative things happen to us, it makes us angry, we do more negative things, until we just completely bottom out. There's nothing that we can do anymore that will bring us any lower. And we suddenly have this insight. We suddenly, out of our suffering, arises this act, which starts to bring us forward again. So when we talk about merit, and when these old Zen masters are talking about people engaging in the practice of gaining merit, what we're seeing is it's something that we also don't admire when we see it in business, when somebody's doing something just for what they get out of it, or in other religious practices, buying our way into heaven, you know, having these lives which are sort of dirty and nasty and trying to do things which the church says will, you know, get us into heaven or anything. We don't admire it anywhere, and it's certainly not admired in the Zen tradition either. In fact, the act of going after this, of reaching for this sort of thing that we call good, is a real marker for the fixation with self. Because what we're looking for is a way to perpetuate, to benefit, to comfort, secure the self. To understand the concept or the perspective of this whole cycle in Zen practice, in Buddhism in general, is to understand that where the top is kind of gets skewed from the perspective of Buddhism. In Buddhism, the highest point is actually zero, is actually the middle point, which runs, if you look at the sort of balance of realms, into the human realm. This is the sort of ideal, and it's the reason that it's ideal is because we have this opportunity to find this balance between the grossly physical realms, animals and hells, where there's all kinds of really nasty stuff going on, and yet we're also able to think and experience in the realm of thought, in the realm of spirituality, if you want to call it that, philosophy, art. All of these things can happen in these higher realms, but are also experienceable in the human realm. The function and the value of the human existence, therefore, in Buddhism, is considered highest. The Buddha was not a god. He was not a member of the deva realms. He was not a member of the hellish realms. He was a human being. And it was because he was a human being that he was able to teach in both the deva realms and the hellish realms, if you want to use these sort of colorful metaphors. Okay, so the function, if we're to talk about the cultivation of merit, then would be to obtain the human birth, to obtain the human body, and to come into contact with the Dharma. The Dharma being the ticket out, the way off of the wheel of samsara. This is a really different philosophical bent than what we come with in our tradition and in pretty much every tradition in the world. This idea that we come with is one of, how do I perpetuate everlasting bliss? How do I die and get to heaven so that I can live forever in the kingdom of God and know no suffering and know no pain? Whether that's the Brahmanic manifestation of that, how do I continue to ascend until I'm able to be unified with Brahma and live in the Brahma realms, which are free from suffering. I mean, it's the same story over and over and over again. The Buddha said, the problem is that even Brahma, or, you know, to look at our own religious background, this idea of gods, he never denied. He didn't say gods don't exist. What he did say was that the idea that they're permanent or lasting or separate is the downfall. The lifespan, he would say, of a god is imminently longer or immensely longer than that of a human. And it is that length that leads to its downfall. It begins to take itself as immortal. It begins to take itself as separate. It begins to take itself as not subject to causation. And this is what leads to downfall or the deterioration of gods. One way of understanding the characters in the Indian cosmology is to understand them more as archetypes, roles in a great drama. The actor who plays the role lasting longer or shorter depending on the realm. I'm getting way further into cosmology than I ever intended to today. But being up to my waist, I figure I might as well drown in it. So, so the practice of Buddhism, the perspective is that it doesn't matter if you get all the way to these God realms, if you find yourself in heaven, you're going to make this mistake of thinking that it's forever. You're going to make this mistake of thinking that no matter what you do, because you have been born into this realm of heaven, you can't do any wrong, and you will make mistakes. The fundamental point is that there is nothing in this universe experienceable through the senses or not experienceable through the senses that is free from this principle of cause and effect. This is a praticca samutpada, codependent origination. These principles that the Buddha talked about, there's no boundary to them. There isn't some realm where causation ceases to exist. There isn't some realm where interrelationship doesn't exist. There is no realm where birth and death cease to exist. And this is what he's saying. And for me, I find it tremendously liberating because it provides us with a profoundly consistent teaching. There's no special class of people, of demons, of gods, of anything, flowers, of trees, of animals, of anything that are outside of these fundamental principles. And this is why Huineng says, this great matter is birth and death. It's said, I talk about it in terms of plus and minus. This is the issue, causality, plus and minus, birth and death, arising, dissolution. This is the great matter. I tell you this over and over again, and yet you people keep getting stuck in trying to gain merit, which is fundamentally fixating the self, trying to get better, trying to have more of something. This is what he's talking about here. And this is what I'm talking about all the time. What he's saying is, I'll read what he says actually. You disciples spend your days making offerings, just looking for ways to reap merit, and not for a way out of the bitter sea of samsara. What I see is when we come together, how do we practice? Are we trying to do the job right for some idea that it's going to make us a better person? Are we trying to ring the bells? Are we trying to do the chanting with the idea that I just need to get this right so that someone will think better of me? And sometimes that someone is you. I'll think better of me if I can really just finally get this. I'll think better of me if I can just get the beat solid and everyone chants and comes to me afterwards and says, what a great job I did. And if we're aiming that way in our practice, even if we're able to do every aspect of the practice, even if the Shika says to us, for the first sit you be Jiki, for the second sit you be Shoji, for the third sit you be Densu, and you can do it all the way through, if we come out of it with this idea that now we're really good, I'm good at Zen, we're still involved in this idea of gaining merit. We're still totally immersed and rooted in this idea of permanence, of self. We're still drinking this cocktail of fundamental confusion, craving, and aversion. And so the fifth patriarch says, if you're blind to your own nature, how can you find the doorway to merit? If fundamentally we don't realize that we are one, that we are not separate, that there is no fixated, separate, lasting, permanent self, how can we actually know what is of benefit and what is problematic? How can you talk about merit? How can you talk about compassion? This, I think, is really germane, and I think it's a setup for what's coming, because Huineng is a huge the sutra that converted, we could talk about Huineng, the sutra that inspired him is the Diamond Sutra. And this is the message that keeps being pounded in the Diamond Sutra. The blank that is not blank is true blank. Go ahead. The compassion that is not compassion is true compassion. When we make this fixated choice, when we take this fixated stand and say, I'm going to be good to you, and we make this moral decision that by me being good to you, I'm doing something good, already we've drunk the Kool-Aid. Already we've made this separation between me and you real. We've said, yes, I am something completely separate, distinct, and unique from you. And therefore, I have something that I can do that will benefit you. And I, in doing that, will benefit myself. And so, as long as we're grasping on that, everything that we're doing is just another lashing. It's another shackle to this wheel. Around and around we go. So, so he comes out fairly strongly. And I think, I mean, what the implication is here is that I'm trying to imagine Hongzhen, the fifth patriarch, sitting there with a whole bunch of monks, practicing, and this grubby firewood salesman shows up and just nails it in front of him. So I can only imagine that he says, oh, okay, shit. And I think probably thinks I must be doing something profoundly wrong, because we have this place that's set up for this practice. We have all these practices that are aimed at realizing this, and none of these people are getting it. And this dude walks in off the street and he's got it. I have to hide him. So for the next 8 months, he's got this guy in the back grinding rice, and he's probably going, come on, guys, let's do it. You know? Okay. So he calls them all together, and he's frustrated, and he says, look, all of you people are all just getting yourself more and more deeply involved in this wheel of samsara. You're shackling yourself more and more to this wheel of suffering. And you think that you're getting yourself off of it. But until you get off of it, all these things that you think that are doing are good are actually not helping at all. If anything, they're making it worse. So he says, go back to your rooms and look into yourselves. In those days, there was a ceremonial hall. They're in the Buddha hall here. They're in the Dharma hall. So that's where the master gives talks. But there wasn't always this formal practice together. Each of the monks, groups of monks, would live around the monastery. There was the monks' hall, which was what we think of as a zendo, but it was a living area. The space that you had was 6x3. I've talked about this lots of times. That's your space. So go back to your rooms. He means the monks, you monks, junior monks, students, go back to the zendo and reflect on this. The senior monks, they all have their own little cabins and areas. They have to go think about it. Just go to your room, is basically what he's saying. Go to your room and think about what I just said. And he says, those of you who are wise, make use of the prajna wisdom of your own nature. Now, I find the notes to this really fascinating because it talks about the origin of this word prajna, the Sanskrit. Prajna wisdom is actually kind of like saying something twice. Prajna means that which comes before. And what it's referring to is that which comes before knowledge or concept. It's the foundational awareness and wisdom. So he's saying, those of you who are wise, make use of the prajna wisdom of your own nature. Go back and sit in zazen. Somebody was asking me on Tuesday about koan practice. And I responded with something like, you have to be able to hold that question with something other than your intellect. You have to be able to dwell on the problem or the issue in a koan with something other than intellect. As soon as you start picking at it, as soon as you start trying to pick it up, you've missed it. You've manifested the self and try to figure it out as something which is outside or separate, rather than holding it in the womb of the mother of Buddhas. That's way too sloppy. I better delete that from the talk. You're holding it in this space that is limitless. It is the fundamental wisdom, the prajna, which arises before knowledge. So he tells you, he says, go back to your rooms and look into yourselves. Make use of the prajna of your own nature. Let go into your own Buddhahood. But this is not enough, he says. Each of you write me a gatha. Each of you write me a gatha. A gatha is a poem, a four-line verse, usually. In this, especially at this time, it was a standard training requirement. I guess today's version would be, you know, I'd ask you to write me a one-page essay expressing your understanding of the Dharma. How would y'all like that if I said that? Next month, all of you will submit a one-page essay on the Dharma. You have to demonstrate your understanding of the Dharma. And this was very traditional, actually, for monks to demonstrate their understanding. Fundamentally, in the practice of koan, in sanzen, with a koan master, it happens every time you go into the sanzen room. Demonstrate is the request. Do something, and it's not limited. I quite like the model of sanzen because it's not sort of like, write me a nice flowery poem. Demonstrate your understanding of the Dharma now. It's really difficult because you can't resort to this thinking. You can't resort to allowing yourself to solidify long enough to put two thoughts together. You've got to move. You've got to speak. You've got to sing. You've got to dance. You've got to bow. You've got to shout. You've got to hit. You've got to do whatever it takes to express, to manifest this prajna in appropriate response to the situation that has arisen. Demonstrate. It's difficult, even sitting on the other side of the cushion, when I ask a student to demonstrate. The heat, the temperature in the room skyrockets. Suddenly there's no space for you and me. We have to merge into this single moment, not just so that you can express it, but so that I can see it. It's a mutual dying in a single moment. Can't be spoken about, can't be written about, can only be grasped in a single moment. And in that moment, it's clear to everybody whether it's been missed or... Each of you write me a gatha. When I read your gathas, if any of you understands what is truly important, I will give you my robe and my dharma and appoint you the sixth patriarch. This is high stakes betting. I'm sure that everybody in the room was shocked, because this is something that, you know, up until the fifth patriarch, the patriarchship of the school of Zen went from an individual to an individual. It's not like it is now, where one teacher may have, you know, 15, 20 Dharma heirs. Everyone had one. And so he says, write me a four-line poem, and if somebody gets it, they get the robe. The whole deal, right then and there. Go! I wonder how that would feel. I mean, I'm no fifth patriarch, but if I said, everybody write me a one-page essay on their understanding, the depth of their understanding of Zen, and if somebody really gets it, they can be the abbot of the Zen Center, I'm going fishing. Oh, I think maybe the response would be something like, what happens? I will give you my robe and my dharma and appoint you the sixth patriarch. The last line says, hurry, as if there were a fire. This is something that I also wanted to talk a little bit about. Anytime you hear that metaphor, if there's a fire, or like your head is on fire, the concept of fire is one that's really crucial in Zen practice, because what fire represents is the rapid consumption of what is presently taken to be solid. Even if you look at the first koan, everyone knows Joshu's Mu. The character, the Chinese character for Mu, represents a scroll which stands for knowledge, solidity, definitiveness, that's on fire. So what happens when that scroll is completely consumed? And it's happening in everything that we do. It's happening in our lives. It's happening in our world. It's happening with the food that we eat. It's happening in the chanting that we do. Sometimes when we're doing seshin, I look at incense, you know, and I have this feeling during seshin later on, day four or day five, that, you know, it's like those last... curls of smoke that come out of the incense just before it's completely consumed. Our lives are on fire. The metaphor comes from the Lotus Sutra, in which the Buddha talks about bringing children out of a house that's on fire. And the metaphor is that the world is on fire. So when he says, hurry, as if there were a fire, this fire is the attitude with which we practice Zen. When you're ringing the bell, when you're making offerings of incense, when you're beating the drum, when you're doing your prostrations, when you're setting up the butsudan, the attitude that we have is that this moment is gone already. As soon as we're talking about it, it's gone. I scolded the densu this morning. Don't criticize yourself, because the moment is gone. It's already been consumed by fire. You can't moan it, or already you're wasting this moment with the same mistake. And then you'll say the next moment, always crying about what you've just thrown into the fire. There's no space or energy or benefit. Everything is going into the fire. And we need to practice like that. So when we're making an offering, not doing it, I've got to offer some flowers at the butsudan today, so it'll do. Or, gosh, that period's over, better ring the bell. You know, that'll do. That'll do is the perspective of something that is lasting, that I'll get a better chance to do that next time. We only get this moment once. We only get this life once. We only have this opportunity to realize our nature once. And then it's gone. Hurtling around the wheel of samsara, taking a really long bet that we're going to find ourselves in this situation again. This is what I always talk about when people start talking about karma. If they're talking to me, I'll say, from the perspective of Zen, the value of merit gaining is to obtain a human life and to be exposed to the Dharma. The fact that we are sitting together, the fact that we're in this room practicing the way, should be understood to be success. You've done it. Having arrived at this position, there is just one thing to do. It's like if you imagine a great circular tunnel that has no exits. Suddenly it's pointed out that there's just one point, a very small point, where there's a keyhole. And you have to keep moving around this circle. Understanding that at that point where the keyhole is the way out, and arriving there, you start talking about what you're going to do on the next cycle. It doesn't make a lot of sense. So now that we've arrived at the keyhole, the only thing we should be focused on, the only thing that we should be practicing, the only thing that we should be worried about, is opening that door. Realizing our nature. Okay, so I'm going to stop there, because that would move into section 5. So we'll find out what this is. Offerings. Okay, I just want to mention one more thing about offerings. Making offerings. Making offerings, we do this a lot. Anytime somebody stands up at the butsudan, whether it's the shoji serving tea, whether it's the jikijitsu offering incense, whether it's me offering incense, and even actually the way that this is set up, we've tried to emulate it a little bit more, but if you think about the Buddha's birthday, or any time where there's a formal zendo setup where I've given a talk, the positioning of the teacher's platform is facing the butsudan, because it's an offering. The word teisho, which is what we use in our tradition for a Dharma talk, means to present a shout. It is, the talk is this demonstration. Show me the understanding of the Dharma. Express your realization. Express your understanding of this teaching. And that's what the job is when you're presenting a Dharma talk. You have to be able to let go of this fixated self, what's of benefit to you. Sometimes you have to yell at people. Sometimes you have to criticize people. Sometimes you have to say things which may not be of benefit to the personal self that's saying them, but is absolutely clear, absolutely clearly a demonstration of your understanding of the Dharma. So, that will be it for today. In Teisho, we have this wonderful opportunity to listen to this story of the sixth patriarch and the sixth patriarch's disciple, or the fifth patriarch's disciples, which includes the sixth patriarch. We have this opportunity to kind of distance ourselves from it in time and space and personality and say, ha ha, those silly people. I think probably all of us identify ourselves with the sixth patriarch, maybe. This is a great way to practice, is to look at how we do this with these stories. It's the same practice that we engage with when we're practicing koans. And rather than doing that, rather than looking at this as some inanimate story about fictitional characters or even real characters that exist outside of time and space, our time and space, to realize that we are being displayed in all of our various forms in this story. We are the sixth patriarch. We are the fifth patriarch. We are the head disciple. We are the body of students who obstinately refuse to write, refuse to express, refuse to behave as if there is a fire. We are the cowards. We are the people who are angry and want to kill Huineng. This is how we practice when we're investigating a sutra, or we're investigating Teisho, or we're investigating a particular teaching of Zen. Rather than holding ourselves outside of it, outside of the story, outside of the teaching, we have to immerse ourselves. We have to let go into this activity, not being distant from it, but being intimately a part of it. Because in doing this, we recognize the truth that this experience is not something outside of us. The Buddha and the six patriarchs are not these people that existed thousands of years ago, but they are the present moment.